This is We All Be News and Radio.
Ron Hurd, get up out of bed. Let's go, Ron Hurd. That's the word. Get out of bed. Give me a jingle. My number 051. Get out of bed. Let's go. Don't be afraid. This is Herb Smith calling you. Herb Smith. All right, I know you're famous and all that kind of stuff, but let's go. Get out of bed.
Welcome back, family, to another wonderful edition of the Artivist Presents We All Be Radio. I'm your host for the Empowerment segment, R2C2H2, the Artivist, also known as Brother Ron. And we're broadcasting live on this super, super, super Sunday. It's not because of football, baby. It's because we're talking about the truth and disseminating that information. Please feel free to join this important discussion. Area code 646-652-4593. That's area code 646-652-4593. If you're ready to get on the air, we're going to open up the chat room. So if you got any questions or comments for our guests, please feel free to post them there. And guess what? They may be read on the air. So without further ado, we're talking about the HIV-AIDS conspiracy today. A lot of important information to get out there. A lot of points of views to discuss. But before we get too deep into it, I want to play a clip of Brian Fisher, this guy. I guess he's a right winger, whatever. But he's talking about AIDS and poppers, this drug called AIDS and poppers. And we'll go from there to introduce our wonderful guest. And there was Brian Fisher talking about one theory that well-known microbiologist Peter Duisberg has proposed about the HIV-AIDS origins, or the conspiracy, rather. And we're going to be talking about today. Today's topic, of course, is We All Be Radio, the download truth on the HIV-AIDS conspiracy. The download truth on the HIV-AIDS conspiracy with none other than Bobby Dick Gregory. And also, we're going to introduce our guest. Of course, you already know who one of our guests is, but another guest is Brother Steve F. Meekin. He's also known as a doctor, but he's Brother Steve F. Meekin, a very humble brother. Brother Stephen F. Meekin, a National Magazine Award winner for excellence in reporting, has more than 40 years of experience working on international health and environmental issues. He was chief of the UNICEF Nutrition Program in Bangladesh, an advisor to the World Health Organization's Global Program on AIDS. He was a consultant to the United Nations on the linkages between environment and health. Mr. Meekin has training in epidemiology and biostatistics from the University of Massachusetts and in anthropology from Cambridge University in England. He has numerous publications to his credit. He was twice awarded the position of Distinguished Visiting Scholar at the University of Iowa Center for International and Comparative Studies. His landmark work, Depo Provera, A Critical Analysis, in 1980, was the first to identify serious health problems associated with the contraceptive that were confirmed in subsequent decades by medical researchers and the FDA. He is currently completing a book entitled White Plague, Blood, War, and the Missing History of AIDS. Stephen, it's an honor to have you on today. How you doing?
Oh, I am so delighted, to be on with Dick Gregory. Can I tell a quick Dick Gregory story before we get into the business?
Yeah.
Okay. Dick, years ago, in 1968, I was organizing a counter-commencement at Stony Brook University in New York.
Yeah.
And we thought, who would be the perfect person to come and speak? So I figured, how do I get a hold of Dick Gregory? So I wound up dialing Chicago Information. And the phone rang. A woman answered the phone. She was clearly carrying a baby. I could hear the baby, her rocking the baby back and forth. And she sounded very interesting. And she said, well, what's the date? And I gave her the date and said, no, he's going to be in jail that day. So
that was Lillian. That's the wife. And today we're celebrating the 65th anniversary of being wed.
Oh, how wonderful. How absolutely wonderful. And who is the baby?
68. I don't know. We have 10 children, so I'd have to didn't know immediately. I wouldn't know.
Right, but there you are. There you are out putting yourself on the line, going to jail and everything, you know. And so you've been a hero of mine for a long, long time. So for me, I'm just really honored to be sharing this line with you.
Thank you for your time and your energy that you have put out there doing what you're doing. Let me just say this, and then we'll get into the discussion. I known for years that the problem had never been freedom or equal rights. The problem had been liberation. I've had 20 PhDs, $10 billion in the bank, and all the education. It's never been education first over liberation. Think about when we battled the British and won, or this wouldn't be America today. Everybody's talking about Harvard or Yale. We're going to build a Harvard or Yale. We're going to take the London School of Economics. They was talking about liberation. The universal God don't give a damn about how many degrees you got. You know, all those degrees, you haven't got nobody can put this human body together like the universe did way back then. That was before the church, huh? That was before the dinosaurs. We hooked them to the church, and I love it. But don't take the place of the church. There was no Vatican 2 billion years ago when dinosaurs disappeared. And so when you stop and think about, you got a handful of evil, basically old men, that have put this together, and they understand because they have the money and the resources to examine and know how this works. And so when they do that, I mean, let me give you a small example. They talk about condoms. It's a easy way to protect yourself. Well, condoms is made out of rubber. All rubber has holes in them, too small to see with the human eye. So when you put it under a magnifying glass, you see the hole in its side. What do they call it? Five metrics or whatever. Five. That's what the holes are.
Mm-hmm.
HIV,
microns.
Huh?
Microns.
Yeah, five microbes, okay. HIV, AIDS is one microbe, huh? I know this, and they don't know it. So that means if you put a rubber on, the AIDS virus could get through a hole that's five microbes, one joined up with two of his partners on each side, and go through. And so this is what they put out here for us. They wouldn't even think about saying, well, look, put two condoms on, because the odds of matching those holes is 3 to 1. And so all of this, and then we come down and take a group of ignorance that was promoted. Ignorance that was promoted. I mean, my mother, you know, she would pick up ignorance and thought it was real. She would say, you know, we always quote, when the white folks she worked for made her mad, she'd hear her say, God said a rich man got as much chance of getting into heaven as a camel's head getting through the eye of a needle. So I'd get some of my hip brothers, all of them wasn't hip. And I said, she got to be crazy. He didn't have needles then. So when I confronted my mother, she said, God knew there would be needles one day.
Uh-huh.
Okay, now watch this now. So I've always believed that if I ever made it big, and I didn't know what it was, show business or what, that the first thing I owed to myself is hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars worth of treats just to unmess up my mind from I got at home from a white racist sexist system, okay? And so one of the things I was able to do was my oldest daughter, Michelle, I told her, now, what you need to do if you finish your understudies is go to the London School of Economics and major in sex harassment at the workplace. Sex harassment. And she did. She got 2 PhDs in sex harassment at the workplace. Took her 8 to 10 years because no one had ever got advanced studies in sex harassment. And so she's cutting new territories. There was no books written on it. And so when she gets through, She goes around the world now, and if she came in to testify for you in sexual ethics, they can't bring nobody else in because she's the world authority by white folks' count. Okay, that's the protocol. Okay. So what I'm saying is that until you understand what is going on and how it's going on, you know, and so one day I find out as I'm traveling and looking, and I'm going from one Arab country to another, and when I leave the Arab country, there's an ark. And when you go to another Arab country, there's another ark. Just like when you leave one state driving, you see all them signs on the highway. Okay? And so I didn't know that ark is called a needle's eye. And then it makes sense. It makes sense. A rich man got as much chance getting into heaven as a camel has been through the eye of a needle. That's a needle. So all it means is the more the load, the more you got to stoop. Oh, that's beautiful, huh? But if you get it mixed up through some ignorance that come from home that didn't know, just yah, 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 then it's not that beautiful. And so what I'm saying is once we sit and stop and look at what they're talking about and feeling it, and now you got young folk coming through now, all that stuff about respect your mother and father, huh? And honor your mother and father. I scratch it out of my Bible and say, if they're honorable. You mean I'm supposed to honor Hitler with what he did? There might be another word I'll use, the fact that he's my father, but the word show ain't honor. And so you got young folks coming through now and figuring this out and figuring this out and figuring this out, and eventually we'll be into reality, and then true liberation will start. That's what Malcolm was talking about, liberation, and the civil rights movement was talking about education. Educate this. Can you imagine Jews begging Hitler after the war and the Nazis to educate them and their children? Are you crazy? Somewhere. And so again, you know, we look. And finally, I say America is probably the richest country in the world with the most educated, not the better educated, with the most educated. America is less than 1/6 of the world's population. And yet we consume 98% of the world's hard drugs. So there is a universal God that said, with all your PhDs and all of that and all your money, you're violating me, and that's why you got to stay high and stay drunk all the time. And so now as we turn this around, and the big boys know it. They know what they're doing. They had me believing for years that the Ku Klux Klan determined public policy. Those of them I couldn't even read or write. Hadn't been to school, and those that had been to school were some little schools you never heard of. And you're going to tell me that them thugs determined public policy, not the First National Bank, not AT&T, not Sears and Roebuck, and now they got us believing the Tea Party. The Tea Party determined public policy. They do that to trick us so we won't see the Rockefellers and the Mellons and the DuPont. The AIDS virus was put together at Case Western Institute, okay, in Cleveland, Ohio. Oh, man, the president went crazy when I sued them. We went all the way in the federal court, and that federal judge said, you give up the information to Mr. Gregory or somebody going to jail, okay? I have it all, okay? That's where it was put together at. And then they moved it to Cleveland General Hospital. Who is that? That's Rockefeller, huh? Now watch this here. You don't have to be too smart to figure out what I'm going to tell you now. In the early days of AIDS, there was no black folks, no minorities, no Indians that had it. Come on, y'all. It was only white folks. And where were they? Not all over America. It was in Manhattan, New York, and San Francisco. Now think about this. All you got to do is answer a simple question. Because they had us believe in AIDS was a white folks thing. Huh? Wow. Some folks, are they being punished by God? Well, I'm saying, well, wait a minute. What about the AIDS in Gooseneck, Tennessee? What about the white AIDS in Chicago? how come they not getting it since it's a white thing, huh? And then all at once, after they established it, you see, if the three of us going to start killing mothers, then the best thing for us to do is kill our mother first and nobody will suspect us. So if only white folks had it on the planet, just in America, then when they moved it into Africa, into the black neighborhoods, nobody would suspect. That's how they do it. And then we sit and we look. And that white boy you played a little while ago,
mm-hmm.
it was amonitrate. That was the then they throw it. Amonitrate is what they gave you. If you had a heart attack, you put that under your tongue, it's impossible for you to die, okay?
Yeah.
And then they start putting it. See, he has this one thought mind, and the problem with them kind of right-wingers, they love America just like the Nazis love Germany. The decent Germans love Germany. And they would never see this as an American problem, as an American conspiracy. So then they say, yeah, you're right, Papas. I told everybody, especially my gay friends, that use YK gel, they don't use it. They'll probably put them to gel in, huh? They'll probably put them there. If you're going to use condoms, wash them. They'll probably put it in that. And so this is what you get from seeing where I've been, dealing with the folks I've dealt with, knowing the different things that they do, and the trillions of dollars of research they have to be able to promote it. You look at that incident that happened in outside of Washington last week, where the guy went into the mall and killed two people. Well, what they don't tell you is the FBI got there before the local police. Are you serious? The FBI got there before the police? Then we find out he took a cab. Now, he's working part-time at McDonald's. Part-time. Not two jobs, one job. He took a cab from Silver Springs to the mall, which is about 30 miles. And nobody said, where'd he get the money? Where'd the money? The rifle he bought cost, I think it was $400. He paid cash for it. Now, they might can explain it, but where did he get the money? Then you go to his house and you find, you see, first, if I'm going to go and kill somebody, not my family, or not some friend of mine that double-crossed me, I'm just going to go and kill at random, huh? Then why didn't I go in there and shoot up everybody? Since I know I'm going to commit suicide, huh? I made up my mind. I'm going to go, so why don't you take everybody out? If you look at the TSA agent that was killed in Los Angeles, they got the guy and they said, yeah, well, I'm just mad. I just wanted to shoot me some TSA agents. So now here's what he did in L.A. He gets all the way past whatever security they have, huh? And he goes in and he shoots the one TSA. Now, any of y'all ever been to an airport, you know there's 8 to 12 TSA agents in that same area because you got more than one scanner. So if he mad at TSA, ain't nobody chasing him. How come he didn't shoot a bunch of them? Then he went upstairs on the escalator and came back down, you know, like 4 minutes later and shot the guy again. Oh, wait a minute. Where was the police? You mean gunfire in an airport? And you can go to the second floor and come back and shoot the same person? So when you got shows like this show here, where these type of topics can be discussed, now the government has to answer. Hmm? Well, you know, I heard on such and such a show that he went up and came back. So now the government last week said, two L.A. cops have been not put off the force, but have been temporarily removed the duty because those were the two guys that were supposed to have been guarding that area, and both of them decided to take a coffee break at the same time. And so, again, I'm saying it's out there, but we've been so trained to look at a certain pattern. And remember, I'm like 84 years old, man. I mean, 83. And here's what happened, man. They had NBC, CBS, and ABC. I didn't have television. We just sitting there watching, listening to the news. You know how dumb you got to be to listen to a tap dancer on the radio?
Mm-hmm.
You know what that's about? And so I say that to say this. Because we have good research, All of us out here know, we know Bin Laden was killed. December 2001, not 18 months ago. December 2001, we know the guy that killed him, Sheikh Ahmad, the same guy that beheaded the Wall Street Journal press guy. Okay, now let's front forward. So now they tell us 18 months ago when the president said, we got him. Is the president calling? Because no, he don't know. The president don't know what's going on. Are you serious? The people, you know how long the CIA has been there? He didn't know. When he get in, he just changed the tops of it. What about them people in there for a year? They got two sets of books. Now, finally, I say this. We all heard the Navy SEALs, six of them went up to the room. Six of them went up. One shot him in the head, he became more famous. Are you all aware that all six of those Navy SEALs have been killed since they've been back in America? The New York Times didn't tell you. The Washington Post didn't tell you. All they told you is five Navy SEALs was killed in a helicopter crash the other day. And then a few days later, they tell you another Navy SEAL, that was the one that claimed he shot him in the head. The other Navy SEAL was killed out on the rifle range training with other Navy SEALs, shot him in the head accidentally. And so again, I'm saying this is the most corrupt, the most vicious, but you can't explain that to my grandmother if she was alive. Because America is beautiful. And so somewhere, when I think about brothers like you, my man, who's done your homework and your research, and they'll even trip that on you, huh? That's what them grants are about. But to able to pull away and then have some place where you can say what you're fixing to tell the audience today. See if you can do it on NBC or CBS or ABC. Or always when they have them type of shows where they're tripping, they always bring the counterpart, okay? The great thing about this social network, they just want to hear your information, and they're not going to bring nobody there to debunk it or to do this or do that. And so I just thank you, brother. Love and bless you. And happy
thank you so much. That's a beautiful introduction. I really appreciate it because, you know, you brought it around just to kind of the main point that if all this stuff comes at you and everybody says, oh, this is it, this is the truth and so on, and some of it just didn't make sense to me. And, mm-hmm. You know, I mean, when I first heard that suddenly it's Africa, you know, and black people and so on. I said, wait a second, I've heard that song before. You know, I've heard that for a long, 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 long time. And when I first got involved in this, there were certain things that didn't ring true to me because I had been to Africa. And they were saying, well, the problem with AIDS in Africa is that everybody's oversexed. And, you know, Africans can't control themselves sexually, and that's why it's happening. I said, well, wait a second. They're like devout people of this, you know, it didn't make sense. It was just like, they made suddenly all of these people knew, I mean, the vastness of Africa, as particularly south of the Sahara, and they knew everything about everybody's sex life. And I said, well, this doesn't make sense to me. And then, because of my work over the years, I was thinking about, well, what about dirty injections and things like that? Because over the years, I mean, I've seen like pathetic cases of insects who had terrible abscesses and so on and so forth, because basically syringes and needles were being used over and over and over again. And people didn't have the supplies, they didn't have the equipment to keep things going, but they were using a lot of injections. They kept on thinking, oh, this Western medicine, this is going to solve everything. So if you do injections and transfusions, you'd be astounded. There were children who had, you know, literally, you know, hundreds of transfusions in their first year of life in some parts of Central Africa. So I began to, this got me thinking. I said, well, you know, and I remember the early African AIDS literature. It was about, well, it's either injections or sex. And then suddenly they decided, well, though, the only solution is condoms. It has nothing to do with healthcare system. And nothing was really done to clean up the healthcare system, which is, you know, tremendously overburdened. people were getting, you know, with malaria and so on, sickle cell anemia, people were getting transfusions and so on. So if the blood supply starts getting infected, if the syringes start getting infected, it's a very, very rapid way to speed the virus.
Sure.
So along the way, I was also thinking, well, you know, like you were, well, where did this come from? How did this happen? I had a couple of fortunate finds in old bookstores. I used to browse old bookstores, look at old medical books. And in this little town of Vermont I live in, I found a bunch of books. And the subject was called Dermatology and Syphilisology from the 30s and the 20s.
Mm.
So an AIDS-defining illness, one of them is a disease called Kaposi's sarcoma. And it particularly struck gay men with AIDS later in the 80s. And the AIDS literature always said that before AIDS, this was a benign disease of elderly men, mostly Jewish and Italian. They, you know, kind of like a skin rash that, you know, didn't kill people and so on. And later when AIDS came, it started striking young men, people in their 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s even. You know, but they said if you get Kaposi's sarcoma under 60, it's clinically like AIDS, unless they wound up having radiation or some other kind of chemotherapy or something. So I start going through these books, and they're talking about cases of people in their 20s and 30s, and they're saying it's fatal, and it invades all the internal organs. That was another thing. AIDS-related Kaposi's sarcoma invades the internal organs. This other one was a superficial skin disease. So I said, I'm going to have to go back to the source. This is really confusing me now because this wasn't supposed to exist. So I said, well, all right, let's go back into the man Kaposi and see what he had to say on the subject. So I wound up getting a translation of his first paper, which was published in 1871 in Vienna. He was at the largest hospital in Central Europe at the time and whatever. And he was an expert on syphilis before that. And he says, this isn't syphilis. They used to call everything that was around, anything. They called it great pox or syphilis or something. And he says, this disease that he discovered the first, he could separate it. He was a smart man. He had this clinical eye. He could figure out the difference and so on. And he separated that. I said, no, this isn't syphilis. This is a different disease. And it's inevitably fatal. Now, this wasn't supposed to have happened. It's the first person who definitively identified this disease. And he says it's fatal, and then you get people writing in the 1980s and say, "Oh, it wasn't fatal before. It wasn't fatal until we had AIDS." So then I decided, well, let me go forward. Now we got the first paper. Let me go. So I wound up looking at every single published study I can find. That was before the internet, and so on. That's when research was fun. You go in these old musty libraries, you bring piles of books, and you go through them, and you read all kinds of interesting things without advertisements and pop-ups and all these other kinds of things. And I looked at 120 years of literature on the subject, and there were at least more than 100 cases of Kaposi's sarcoma in young men that killed them. This wasn't supposed to have happened. So I said, uh-oh. So this is an old disease. It's been around. All right. Now, there are numbers of different kinds of diseases that AIDS can cause because it undermines the immune system and things which are usually like this. You could have this. It turns out the Kaposi's sarcoma is caused by a virus. But if your immune system is in shape, it does nothing.
Right.
But if you get HIV, the AIDS virus, with Kaposi's sarcoma, it becomes a deadly cancer. So for me, the question became, so what happened with the AIDS virus? Clearly to me, when I looked at these cases, it seems to me there were two things going on. The Kaposi's sarcoma virus was there because they had Kaposi's sarcoma, and HIV was there because they had this deadly form, which didn't exist otherwise, unless you had, like, you know, modern chemotherapy, radiation, so on and so forth, or transplantations, or, you know, immunosuppressive drugs. So I look at this, and I say, well, all right, then something had to change. And along the way, I realized that something very important changed, and that's called the Second World War. So according to the conventional AIDS wisdom, the virus began to they say the virus began with an accident between a hunter and a chimpanzee in Cameroon, now they're saying, in West Africa.
Yeah.
And I said, well, you know, there may be this, you know, genetic connections, evolution, so on and so forth, is all very interesting. But that doesn't tell me how it started. What changed the most during the Second World War. They're saying it happened during the time of the Second World War. They're not mentioning, they're saying the 1940s. I'm saying 1940s, the whole world was going crazy in the 1940s.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a major innovation in the Second World War was transfusion medicine, the blood supply.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Before that, transfusions were very rare, very experimental, and so on. By the end of the Second World War, all right, over 13.8 million people in the United States donated blood, and most of that, 10.5 million units, became what was called freeze-dried plasma.
Right.
So this was an incredible breakthrough. You know, you could get it down. They'd make it so cold and so on and so forth, and you get this white powder, and you take distilled water, and the paramedic could be at the front line and give it as a transfusion. But there's a really ugly side to this story, You've heard of Charles R. Drew, you know, the pioneer in transfusion medicine.
Yeah.
You know, without
died,
whom,
died from the lack of a transfusion.
He bled to death. But I won't get into that now. But I'd love to talk about it another time.
Not.
All right, but he did die. He died in a car accident. What happened was, my understanding, there's a wonderful woman down at University of North Carolina named Love, who wrote a wonderful book about all of that, and basically. I think what happened was, they realized it was Charles Drew. It was a small hospital. They didn't know what to do. But the interesting thing is, so they let him. They started treating him upstairs, but the other doctors with him, they treated downstairs. You know, Charles Drew.
I'm sorry. We got into this. He was with light complexion.
Yes, he was.
When the ambulance got there, they had no idea they were not white.
Well, that's very possible. I agree with you. That's very, very possible. Eventually, they learned from the other gentleman that it was Charles Drew. But I think that's true. But he was, I mean, this man had a reputation. But I want to get to a certain point about this, Dick, which is really important. So what happened was, at first, they decided, when they're doing the blood program, even though Charles Drew pioneered the blood forbidden program, showed how it can be done, how you can do it on a large scale and all of that, the War Department, the Red Cross, and everybody said, oh, yeah, but we're not going to take black people's blood.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're going to say that white soldiers are not going to want to have black people's blood.
Yeah.
You know, and so people, you know, in those days, you know, the community was organized. You had, you know, these wonderful newspapers and so on all over the country, and people, they were protesting at the centers and so on and so forth. So they finally gave in. But what they said is, what they were going to do, they're going to segregate the blood.
Right.
You know, they're going to have black people's blood and white people's blood. And then, for making the plasma, they kind of, you know, what they did is, they said, we're only going to use white people's blood. Because there were these fears that if a white man got black people's blood, his grandchildren could turn out black. Just the stupidity, you know, that was going around. Just the ignorance was just absolutely incredible. So the name of my book, the book I'm working on, is called White Plague, Blood War and the Missing History of AIDS. And the reason why I called it White Plague is because you had an experiment.
Well, hold on. Is that sold in stores now?
No. I'm still looking for a publisher. Dick, help me get a publisher. We'll get to that later. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. That's very important.
It's very important. It's really important. I mean, I put in 15 years of hard work on this. Believe me, and I got some really good endorsements for it too as well. So what happened was, all right, they decided that to make this freeze-dried plasma, you concentrate blood from different people and so on, but they excluded black people's blood to make this. And it turns out, I showed later, when you look at what happened with AIDS and so on, I show that freeze-dried plasma was the ideal medium for spreading, transmitting, and getting the HIV virus around to lots and lots of people. You would think the process of freeze-drying would kill the virus, but it did just the opposite. Same with hepatitis. So later, a lot of people who got the plasma developed hepatitis, you know, but they didn't know about HIV. So this was one major change. So, and then what you see is, in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 50s and 60s and so on, you have more and more understanding of immune suppression. And you get to the point where, in fact, there was a big conference down in Sanibel Island in Florida, where there are this handful of people who are the only people who really know about medical immunology, have a conference, and they use the term AIDS. They, honest to God, use the term AIDS in a 1968 conference. Mm-hmm. All right? And there's a team from the University of Minnesota that is headed by Dr. Robert Good, who was the first person to realize the thyroid gland produced T cells, which were involved in immunity. T cells become later important in AIDS.
Mm-hmm.
They start looking for a virus in the lymph nodes of people with what they called AIDS, acquired immune deficiency states, is what they called
mm-hmm.
it. All right. So for me, the question then becomes: it's always been around. It was around in the 1870s. I even know it was around in the court of Louis XIV. We'll get into it now, but it had been around, okay? But why did it take off? Why did it explode when it did? All right? Well, part of it is, of course, people didn't know how to diagnose it. Nobody would have thought Kaposi's sarcoma was a sexually transmitted disease, for example.
Mm-hmm.
And then the pneumonia, pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, which killed most people with AIDS, it wasn't even diagnosable in the States until the late 1950s.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, they died of pneumonia, didn't respond to antibiotics, all right?
Yes.
So for me, then, the question becomes, what happened? And a couple of things happened. One is, at first, they didn't want to take black people's blood,
mm-hmm.
all right? In fact, the state of Arkansas, you know, segregated the blood supply until about 1967
yes.
or 68.
By love.
That, right, you know, and at other states as well. But suddenly they discovered they can make a buck off of it. They can
mm-hmm.
make a big buck off of it. And prisons became a major place for harvesting blood plasma.
That's right.
So if you're in the Angola prison, and for your work, you're getting 6 cents an hour, and then you can, you know, then suddenly this plasma thing comes along, and they'll give you $9 for a pint of plasma, and you can donate twice a week,
mm-hmm.
it changes your life.
Right.
You know, it and so on. So people were donating like crazy.
Yes.
This happened all over the country. But
mm-hmm.
people were donating. I mean, you had people with tracts on their arms, people who by that point were addicted to heroin, so on and so forth, are all donating. This is being collected and being pooled into vats of 20 to 50,000 units at
That's
a time.
Right.
A single infected unit could destroy the whole vat. And eventually, what I show is that plasma, the United States exported $1 billion a year worth of blood products.
Mm-hmm.
We had the lowest safety standards of any industrialized country in the world. A
yep.
single person could donate 104 times a year.
Okay.
They were relying on, you know, IV drug
could
users.
You,
they were relying on...
Could you put a period there for a second?
Sure.
Oh, brother, can you speak up a little bit? Can you speak up a little bit? We have an issue
sometimes,
there.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I can hear you fine.
And sometimes you get those super gangster guards.
Yeah.
That would make you double three times as much.
Yes.
And so you've had like 10, 15 people dying, and they got around it by saying it was a rod. Huh? And that's how they were killed.
Right, right.
And nobody thought different because they're in jail, right? Who cares? Okay, I'm sorry. But that's where that was coming from.
I'll wrap it up. All right. So what happens
But
I think this is really important because I think, you know, we're coming from really from the same place in terms of, for me, when they started blaming Africa, I practically laughed because I said, well, of course they're going to do that. I mean, you know, like, you have a whole history of that. And yet they put on the scientific coding and so on and so forth, and they're not using common sense. All right. Because the question is, if in fact it came over from Africa, all right?
Yep.
And people have been hunting chimpanzees for thousands of years as part of the natural ecology, right?
Yep.
So why didn't we see it when we had 400 years of the great misery when, you know, what, 14, 15 million people from West Africa
mm-hmm.
were brought to this country?
Yep.
You know, to the Caribbean, why didn't we see it then? I mean, it makes no sense. It
yep.
makes absolutely no sense. Why suddenly this one chimpanzee with this one African hunter who nobody ever met, and then somehow or another he, because he was so oversexed, spread it all over the world? You know, it just kind of like, no, there are too many stereotypes, too many things I've heard before. All right, so I think what happens is we get to the 1970s, all right? And so the virus has been here. It's been in America for a long, long time. It's been in Europe and so on. But again, what kind of changed things? Why did it start taking off? And by the way, in the 1960s, I even have hemophiliacs who were diagnosed with acquired immune deficiency states and pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, this AIDS-related virus. So, I mean, it, you know, but these numbers were small. Why did it take off so big? Well, one part was this plasma business, this plasma industry. But the other thing is the heroin epidemic. Why did heroin take off as big as it did in the 1970s? I mean, there was some of it was going on in the 60s and the 50s. It was part of the bebop thing and so on.
Sure.
But this thing, like, really took off. And again, I think, you know, one part of it is Vietnam. I think that the Vietnam War played a major role in stimulating the heroin epidemic in a number of different ways.
Mm-hmm.
On one hand, a lot of people got addicted to heroin in Vietnam. The Vietnamese government was involved in selling it and so on. All right. The other thing is it further weakened the country. It's, you know, all the money was taken out of the cities.
Sure.
The war on poverty became the war on drugs. More and more people were being arrested and locked up. More and more veterans are coming back who are homeless with PTSD and were attracted to it, you know. And so a lot of people were using heroin. So the numbers of heroin users shot up, you know, by, so like in 1965, they were thinking, these are kind of just off the top of my head, and these, and of course these things are always estimates. They're thinking about maybe 50,000 heroin users in the country.
Mm-hmm.
By 1978, you're talking about 750,000.
Yeah.
You know, it's, you know, a lot of heroin's being used. People can't have clean paraphernalia, because if you're caught with, you know, with a clean syringe or something, you go to jail, you know, and so on. So people are sharing works and so on and so forth. So you have these outbreaks of hepatitis. You have hepatitis C, hepatitis B, but you also have HIV. And what we and what happened is in New York City, all right, in New York City, the earliest known case of an IV drug user who came down with AIDS was also a man who had sex with men.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and then you have three young children. One of the earliest cases in New York, when they kind of go back and try to you know, investigate even before the epidemic started, were three young children whose mothers were injecting drugs. So what's happening is the virus moves very quickly among drug injectors and their sexual partners.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And so about 10% a year, the rate is increasing. So actually, even before, you know, by 1975, 76, they think now probably about 20% of IV drug users were already HIV infected, certainly by 1978.
Right.
And a lot of those people are having sex with women, they're having sex with men, so on and so forth. Now, the gay community was very vulnerable at that time because, as that right-wing nut was talking, yeah, people were experimenting with a lot of sex and so on and so forth, and they were getting a lot of sexually transmitted diseases. You know, and a lot of gay activists will be right out in front and say that was the case, that really was the case. But what happened is they weren't getting AIDS. And once you had like this bridge from the IV drug user population who was also having sex with men, plus people in prison and so on and so forth, and all these things mixing up, and the next thing you know, the thing explodes. And from there on, it comes to Africa. You have doctors who had worked in Africa for decades, years and years, both African and European and American doctors who had never seen this before. To them, it was totally new.
Yeah.
So the question is, how did it come into Africa? So I'm saying it didn't come from Africa. It came into Africa.
Right.
And the question is, how did it come in? Well, you know, it comes in. There are only certain ways it comes in. It comes in with blood. Blood products from the United States, mostly harvested from prisons at this point,
mm-hmm.
were being shipped to Europe and transshipped to Africa, all right, and also sometimes directly from the States into Africa. The first people diagnosed with AIDS, first Africans diagnosed with AIDS were very well-to-do people who got their treatment in Belgium or could go to what was the Belgium hospital in Kinshasa.
Mm-hmm.
They thought foreign blood was better than African blood. Well, guess what? The reverse was true. Once it started spreading in Africa, they, you know, you start these research projects, and they said, well, Africans are oversexed. That's the only thing that happens. You have research projects, and this is a real tragedy. $40 million a year, U.S. government, Belgium research project called Project CETA. All right? CETA is French for AIDS, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And what happened was, they were screening blood for research purposes in the largest hospital in Central Africa. In those days, it was called Mamayemo Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now I think it's called Kinshasa Hospital. And they were screening blood for research purposes, but not to protect patients. So this is just like Tuskegee,
yeah,
all over again, but on a bigger scale and with AIDS. So So, you know, they start talking condoms are the solution, but they're not cleaning up the blood supply until much, much later. Mm-hmm. They're not cleaning up the injections until much, much later because they think it's so obvious Africans are oversexed. You know, and it's like, it's horrible when you think about it.
Yep.
One last thing, and then I want to get your response, okay?
No, take your time.
Okay, well, here's another thing, all right? Brother Ron had mentioned before that I had done work on this injectable contraceptive, Depo-Provera, and so on. And for years, I said, look, there's some downsides to this drug. There's some downsides. You know, it's very convenient and so on and so forth, but let's look at the downsides. Well, in 2010, things have been building up. There have been questions about the relationship between Depo-Provera and AIDS in Africa. And a study came out, a team from the University of Washington, Seattle, and, you know, with African collaborators and so on, did this incredible epidemiological study, and they found that women who used Depo-Provera doubled their risk of getting HIV infection and AIDS. Mm-hmm. Doubled the risk. Now, when you have so many people getting it, a double risk is phenomenal. You're talking about, you know, millions ultimately. And so, again, the thing comes crashing down. Oh, no, this can't be true, blah, 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 blah. The reality is the science is as good as it can get on this, and yet the drug is still being promoted. I wrote in 1980, the first time I ever heard the word immunosuppression was in 1980 when I was doing my original research, and I found out this was a drug which was used in organ transplants to suppress the immune system.
Mm-hmm.
To help with transplants. It's an immunosuppressive drug, all right? And you're giving it to women, increasing the risk of them getting an HIV infection because the drug is reducing their immune system. You know, and nonetheless, it's still being promoted like crazy, even though it's such a dangerous drug. So my feeling is, you know, you get the same old story, same old, you know, the different ways to look at it. I was lucky because I came across those old books and it started me thinking about, well, wait a second, then this had to be around before. So, so the conspiracy for me is that everybody agreed, well, it makes sense, it had to be Africa, you know, and then you try to get anything else in, and the press, the journals, this, that, so on and so forth, won't even listen to the story. So it's kind of like this, we found the scapegoat, and let's just go with that, we're all comfortable with it, and then the conspiracy is, we're going to give them condoms, but we're not going to clean up the blood supply, and we're not going to have clean injections and so on and so forth. Whereas the only thing that really worked, the most important AIDS prevention in this country, had been screening blood and cleaning up the hospitals, that, you know, which they call universal precautions.
Right.
But yet the virus doesn't operate differently among Africans as it does to people in this country. It made no sense, you know. But so this is where I'm coming from on that.
That's great.
I want to think, before Brother Dick answers, I just want to ask y'all this question, both of y'all.
Sure.
From Screen Time, from the chat room, there's a lot of people listening. And we're going to hit the phone line, so a lot of folks want to hear about everybody around the country calling in. Want to get a piece of this conversation. It's very powerful. I want to thank you both. But the question is from Screen Time in the chat room. Thank you for this question. He want to know why AIDS and HIV have project names instead of Latin medical names. Why do they have project names instead of Latin medical names?
Oh, you mean why they're called a human immunodeficiency virus?
Yeah.
And
like
why
Latin
AIDS
name.
Is called
yeah.
AIDS?
Right.
Or why it's called human? Well, I think it's just because of the behavior. I mean, we knew that AIDS was causing immune deficiency, and they tried to distinguish between what they called simian immunodeficiency virus, which is a type they found in chimpanzees and so on, which is related, but it's not really close to related. It's related. But I think it was just, it kind of, a Latin name, I think, wouldn't have gotten people's attention. I think this is an easier one to hold on to. So I have no problem with the name.
You hear the bed. I was going to say that because my grandmother wouldn't understand that. She can easily remember. Okay, keep on, brother. Keep on.
Dick, I just can't believe I'm on the phone with you. This is amazing to me. You know that?
Well, Brother Greg, what do you got to say? Make sure you speak up, Brother Greg, because people want to really hear what you got to say.
Well,
people are really listening to what you
say. Listen to this.
Mm-hmm.
The German measles. You heard of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Germany had never had German measles. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
For
right.
years, countries we knew we were going to have to tangle with, 40 years from now, we created a disease to already put a negative thought in your head. Now, let me go back. The Asian flu, huh?
Mm-hmm.
And all at once, do you realize the greatest communist country in the world is Russia? Hmm? They call them Russia, communist Russia. They call the Chinese the red Chinese. Well, if the biggest communist on the planet is the Russians, why don't you call them red Russians? Huh? See how it works with the hatred? So then all at once you had the West Nile virus. Y'all remember that?
Mm-hmm.
They said, how did it get to America? Mosquito. Well, how did the mosquitoes get them? On a plane. Whoa, ho, 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 ho. Hold it. Egypt did not have a plane that goes from Egypt to New York nonstop. So how did that mosquito know not to get off at the first stop?
Okay. You know, Dick, you know about syphilis? It used to be that the British called syphilis the French disease.
Yes.
And the French called syphilis the English disease.
Yep.
And at one point they all got together and decided to call it the Italian disease.
Yeah. That's the same thing happened with Constantine. And when all the religions was about to break up into craziness, and that's when Constantine called them in Constantinople and said, you are coming here and we'll figure this out. And he told them point blank, I don't believe in no religion, but I couldn't function without this because it keeps the folks together enough that then I can control it with minimum. They couldn't finish it out if the hatred was so bad. So he pulled the blinds, the curtains open and said, see out there, that's my army. And if this is not solved before sundown, all y'all going to die. And you know how they solved it? Because one group was called the Father, another group prayed to the Son, another group other. When they came out, it was the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
So again,
you look at it. You hear the day or two. Well, in Africa, they're over sex. Well, look, man. In the old days, when the only time I could see an African was either in a Tarzan movie or if I went and I didn't have no reason to go to a white college, 98% of your Africans came to this country was in going to white colleges. How come the rape record didn't go up? Hmm? If they're so oversexed, how come?
But the colleges were oversexed.
And so, again, what you're looking at is it's hard to catch them because they've been out there for so long. Let me read something to you here. I want you to hear this, because this never ran in not one American newspaper or magazine. The only way this ran was in a black magazine that came out, you know, like once every 2 months. And a lot of black folks was into it and dying. It come out, no, every 2 months, yeah. October, November issue. And here's what it says. Action AIDS health warning. Okay, that's the headlines. Now watch this. Follow up on a study presented at the International AIDS Conference in Durban, South Africa. The Center for Disease Control, now listen to this, and Prevention has issued an urgent health AIDS health advisory. Okay. Many people may have been counseled that monoxone-9, okay,
mm-hmm.
which is found in, it's a gel found in condoms, contained in many spermicides, provides extra prevention against HIV.
It's on the way to John.
I hear somebody else on the line.
Brother Steve.
Yeah, he just comes in. He's waiting.
I think he's talking.
Okay, help you to prevent HIV transmission. However, now listen to this. This is the Center for Disease Control. Helps to prevent HIV in a recent study conducted on 1,000 HIV-negative prostitutes in Africa, found that in using minoxidil actually increased, not decreased, the spread of HIV.
Yeah.
Now, this is how the Center for Disease, I keep hearing somebody talking, now I can stop.
Dick, can I just kind of add to that?
Yes.
So they used to say that, well, there was this theory that the reason why prostitutes in Africa were getting infected more quickly than, say, prostitutes in Europe and other places,
mm-hmm.
They thought it might be due to a disease called genital ulcer disease,
mm-hmm. Right.
Or a GUD. And I happen to have read a study, and I realized, I learned that this genital ulcer disease, if you were to take a swab and get some pus or something from genital disease, and you put it on your arm, the skin on your arm, intact skin on your arm, you would develop the same thing. So it's really highly contagious, all right? So they were saying, well, there's this real correlation between, HIV infection, genital ulcer disease. But what they didn't say is, in fact, when they were drawing the blood to see whether they got the HIV virus, they were taking specula and putting them in the vaginas of women to examine their vaginas, all right, and then going from woman to woman with the same specula, either just lightly rinsed with water or not sterilized, whatever. And what they were doing is they're infecting, they're using dirty needles on top to draw blood for HIV, and they're using dirty specula down below, infecting women who've come for examinations. So you're spreading the two diseases at the same time, and then you're going to say the genital ulcer disease is what makes them more vulnerable to HIV.
Sure.
And you don't look at what happened in the clinic.
Okay, there you are. Now watch this now. So they go on to say...
And that's in Kenya.
Yep. So they go on to say that the women who didn't use minoxidil, women who relied upon gel alone to prevent themselves without a condom. Expect. Now, here's what happened. They found out all of the study participants who were volunteers who were aware of the possibility risk, benefited, and the unknown involved. Now the study was conducted among very high-risk women who may have been having sex and therefore using minoxidil several times a day. And now, this is the Center for Disease Control saying, you go to the drugstore today and you can go to the condom section and it says, with minoxidil. They know this, huh? And yet they can, and it's hard for us to believe that they would do stuff like this because we just see this as this good old America, and then there's some ignorant folks, they oversex, they over this. They know what they're doing. And so, Doc, we will talk with her after sometime and see how we can get this book out there because it's very important, very important.
Thank you, Dave.
People,
I appreciate hearing that.
Especially when somebody's doing something with the kindness. We hear it in your voice. The kindness and the love, and then once it's out there, but we'll deal with that. And so Ron, what were you thinking of?
Yeah, it was about it. Well, screen time. He made a good point about. He made a observation. Let me see. He said. He said a couple of things. He said, "Real natural diseases have Latin medical names, not project names. No Latin name means it is man made." And also, I'm going to see that people make some good, people are very active on the board. I want to bring up, too, I want to get y'all input on this. They said Africa is on a population boom, a historic population boom. By 2050, it should be 2.4 billion people in Africa. But yet, the media promotes this AIDS epidemic in Africa, that Africa is dying out. Well, what is the truth?
Well, first you got to look at just some common things.
Mm-hmm.
The poorer you are, hear me now, the more educated you are. That had nothing to do until you get into a system where we put pride on it, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, what school did Jesus go to, huh?
That's
what school
right.
did all them great minds go to that understood astronomy? And them applicants come up with all that research with the stars and all of that, and after we get trillions of dollars worth of instruments, we find them out that they knew just about as much as we did about it, okay? But
mm-hmm.
when you question, you're unprepared if your children is not this and two. What they won't tell you is, one, who created reading? If I get off a plane today in Tokyo, I can't read a Japanese paper. Now, you tell me that universal God made something that changed when you cross a border? Because back then there was no borders. There was no New York or Chicago or Germany or China. And so when you break it down and say, wait a minute, hold it. Something wrong with this picture. And so all at once now, when if you and your wife have PhDs, okay, your child, your children at 5 years old will have a vocabulary of 5,000 words. If you and your wife have just finished college and no advanced education, at 5 years old, your children will have a vocabulary of 2,500. If you and your wife have never been to college, at 5 years old, they will have a vocabulary of 500 words. So, then what do I do? If I haven't been finished high school, my wife didn't finish high school, then we go to the church and we get a rap group, I'm talking about the famous, and find out what are the words that the two PhDs say around their children, or I'm just talking, and then take those words and put some rap music behind it and let the lower income hear it, and they'll have the same thing. Okay? And so consequently, when you sit and you stop about this taint that's on us, not just black folks, but not educated and not this. And so consequently, what happens now is they have studied this, studied it. One of the greatest pieces of research I was able to find in my years of spending money and getting research was Dr. Hauser's invention of dealing with maize, wrapped in a maize. That's the little boxes you put them in. It came out the Illinois Institute of Technology in Chicago. Okay? And what they did is they took a group of...
Somebody got a cell phone or something.
They took a group of mice,
mm-hmm.
and they put them in these little mazes. They were their homes, right? Homes. I want you to hear this now. And they gave them a work plan. Hmm? They gave them a whole love thing, marriage, whole thing with mice, man.
Mm-hmm.
They gave them a work schedule. Every morning, the bell would ring. They'd wake up. They had their breakfast, and then they'd leave to do their work plans, which they had memorized in about 3 weeks. In the evening, they'd come home. They'd fix dinner. They'd feed. It was just a whole family thing. And after a year of that, Dr. Mays, Hauser, they came home and they had doubled the amount of mice to a maze. In 3 weeks, they started raping, stealing, and killing one another. Did you hear that?
Yes, sir.
Now, after they put that piece together, the Illinois Institute of Technology was 35th in state, north state, across the street. Was 35th in South State. They tore all the houses down from 35th South all the way to 55th South and 12 blocks over, and they built the largest housing project that ever been built in the world called Robert Taylor Homes. And the murder rate there was higher than it was at Vietnam. They know what they're doing. We don't know, huh?
Yes,
so we think we're dealing with these ordinary white folks that we don't like. They have nothing to do with it. White ain't a color. It's an attitude. And if you haven't got trillions of dollars in the bank, you can't have the attitude. So while we look at them and think they're the enemy, we don't think about Sears and Roebuck and AT&T. Now watch this out. Now hear me.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the housing project started up. Huh? St.
Mm-hmm.
Louis housing project started up. Then after X amount of years after they perfected, they had to destroy them. Now, density population. Now this one is that blew me away. The three most densely populated areas in the world.
Mm-hmm.
China, India, and the University of Massachusetts.
Wow.
UMass. Huh?
Mm.
Now watch this now. The University of Massachusetts and UMass.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They had a crime rate equal to Chicago.
Mm.
Okay? Because we already know now, once I crowd these spirits in, then the rape, the murder, everything you could think of was higher than Chicago, and including size and all of that. So we know now. But dumb us, we don't know. So we just blame it. Now watch the other thing. The poorer you are in the society, the more you feel inferior because you don't have an education. Hmm? Now watch this. The poorer you are, you look for instant gratification. Huh? Instant gratification. Huh? So what's more gratifying than sex? So it ain't got nothing to do with this or that. It got something to do. But when you got these hang-ups, instant gratification, you go to one of the best restaurants in New York, a cheap bottle of wine will cost you $10,000. When you go to them restaurants, you end up with a cheap deal of, you know, $15,000. Why? It's in the wine. It's in the wine. You can get wine, you can get a bottle of wine for $30,000. Huh? And they don't mind it because it's a tax write-off. All you got to do, I can take a prostitute all the way around the world with me today. And as long as I call her my secretary, it's a tax write-off, okay? And so consequently, when you look for instant gratification, and so you get the cheap bottle of wine, if you gave poor folks some crap that they couldn't feel the results for 6 months, they wouldn't take it. They're looking for instant gratification. That's why you do something like that. Man, I'll go get my gun and blow your brains out. Now the people of substance, they're going to kill you, but they're not going to broadcast it. And so they know this. They understand this, and they know what kind of drugs to put into your food or your water or your drink. For instance, when I was a little boy, I'm born 1932, when I go to school, huh? Schools have thermometers. We have thermometers in every room. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
And I just asked, it's 102 out. What y'all doing with this thermometer? We know it's cold. Okay? And then one day, somebody found out how poison mercury is. Mercury. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So you better not be caught with a thermometer in a school up on the wall. That's a federal violation. In the old days, people, the best filling you could get was mercury filling in your teeth. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you decide you're going to get them out, you go to the dentist. The dentist just can't take it out. The dentist got to call the EPA. They got to register that. The EPA will send them a certain box. They put that tooth in when they take it out. Okay? That's how poison we know it is now. And then that got to be shipped back to the EPA. Now watch this. All the vaccines, the flu shots and all of that. Do you know what preservative they use? Mercury. Huh? Is that crazy?
Mm.
Mercury. They know what mercury do, and yes, they put it in the vaccine. Oh, you go to Safeway and get a free flu shot. Well, I'm going to get a free flu shot. You know, I can't even get a good piece of meat in here. And so when you look and think about the evilness that's there, and the confusion that they start, thing you look at, you know. Right now, they're telling me that there's a legal marijuana, two states. I said, well, wait a minute, are there side effects? I mean, I smoked 4 packs of cigarettes a day for almost 30 years until I found out that nicotine caused cancer and a whole lot of other things, huh? And I was able to quit because I was hooked into liberation. And I can't liberate myself taking something from somebody who's oppressed me. Huh? And so consequently, I look around and you say, well, wait a minute, something's wrong with this picture. They know. So when I was a little boy, oh, they had marijuana back then. I heard the word marijuana, but you knew it was illegal. Then not too long ago, I heard another word. I'm thinking about children now. They hear a word called medical marijuana. So as a child, I said, I got to be sick to use it. And then something happened Christmas week. That was one of the most devastating things that ever happened in the history of this country. Legal recreation marijuana. Now forget about us. Think about the children growing up hearing the word recreation marijuana. They don't have that word on prostitute houses, man. They'll come on there for a little recreation. So now you telling me none of that has side effects? All the ones they tell me now, if I smoked and my wife smoked, or if she worked with my smoke, it's going to have effect on her unborn baby. Okay. You going to tell me that heroin and cocaine have effect on your unborn baby? There's certain medicines you can take because it would have effect on the unborn baby. But marijuana, they give it to me, and there's no disclaimers. What are they trying? And so, again, I'm saying, when you get brothers like this brother we just heard that have put his research out there, put it out there, and he can't get it published. But he was saying everything that the rest of them were saying, oh, the biggest folks out here. So that's our job, man, you and I, to look, not just to bring people on the show, but when you hear a sad note like that, how do we get it out there? Now, we might not be able to. But we got to try, and so I cannot thank you enough, brother.
Thank you, Dick. I want to just quickly chime in. You're talking about the housing projects and all of that stuff,
yes.
And population in Africa. You know, the issue in Africa is, and always has been, it's ripping off the people, ripping off the resources, and so on. So more and more people are basically being forced into more and more slums, more and more cities where, you know, everything is dysfunctional. I just heard like a sad story. I think it's in Uganda now, where some this combination, these church people have come from Tennessee or something, and they're trying to give them the right religion. And at the same time, some companies come from there and said, "Hey, look, we'll give you $25,000, and we just want to be able to have all your mineral rights, all your trees, all your this, all your water rights, so on and so forth, for an area the size of Chicago, Greater Chicago." And this chief sold it to him. I mean, this is like going back to the beads in Manhattan kind of thing.
Yeah,
and
remember,
these people are going to be ripped off blindly.
Remember,
and there's this
know.
Constant. Everybody wants to go to Africa now because they want to rip off everything they can.
Why not, man? Why not? Why wouldn't? Why do you think Jesse James is going to be humanitarian?
Exactly.
Why do you think somebody that tried nuclear experiments on folks, huh?
Right.
All right? So why are we going to ask them to be nice when they never was nice?
Right.
My problem is you got some people that killed my Jesus Christ and then told me to call it a good day, so I called it Good Friday, huh? And I see nothing wrong with that, okay? And so when you stop and you think about all the countries in Africa that don't have no problems and never have, is the ones that have no natural resource. Let me tell you something about Uganda and Idi Amin.
Right.
Uganda could be the breadbasket for Africa. And what's left over could feed half the world. Now, why are they going to let that happen? Now, we forget one thing. Idi Amin didn't get killed in Uganda. Him and 48,000 of his troops got on 747s and left the country. Huh? And nobody said, who's feeding them? Hmm? Where are they getting their money from? Huh? And so all at once, you get them Africans being trained. Come in civilian clothes, come to America, go all over the world, and many of them are terrorists. They don't look African, huh? That's what this game is about. And there's a universal force. If we come together, here's a just heard man talk about, well, is the book out? No, it's not out. Wow, man, what a blessing. Jesus, you did all of that? Where'd the money come from? You got your own money? And now, and so I'm saying, when you stop and think about who you dealing with, Nelson Rockefeller, the richest human being on the planet. He can't read or write, huh? David Rockefeller, one of the greatest bankers that ever lived. He can't read or write, huh? So my black grandchild and children are told, you can't read, you dumb and you ignorant. They call theirs dyslexic, huh? Einstein couldn't read or write, okay? These are games they play, huh? And where did Jesus learn how to read, huh? And there's certain words, when you change it into English, they change into something else. And so you sit and you look, and thank God this young group of children that's coming through, huh? Somebody once wanted to bring me to Canada to be the Father's Day speaker. Come on, y'all don't even have Father's Day in Canada. Why am I coming? Well, Mr. Gregory, you are an example of you married, you've been, I don't want to come up there. Y'all don't have. And plus, you got a wrong person to celebrate as a good father. Why? The universal God said to all of us, your penis, your vagina, that's there to create another me. I'm born with the right to create another God. Not another preacher, another priest, or another pope. To create another God. And I would never ask, what color are you? How many degrees do you have? Where do your mother live? What kind of work do they do? What neighborhood are you living in? How much money you got? I would never ask that. So I've been blessed to create 10 gods. Don't have to have no education, no nothing. My problem is this. When I look in the mirror at myself and realize I have 10 children, I never bought a car. I didn't know the year, the make, the model, the down payment, the monthly notes, the insurance. When I look at myself and realize I put more research in buying a giant car than creating God's new life, I'm the problem, okay? Except now I know it, huh? Every time I took my wife to bed and had sex, I just get me some booty, man. I wasn't talking about creating God's new life, not all at once. Somebody want to tell me, wow, you're wonderful. Oh, am I? Am I? And so again, I'm saying there's a new life, there's a new rhythm. Where was this brother been on the show today talking what he's talking, where my grandmother can hear, even if she don't understand it? She can hear if it wasn't for you, your show, huh? All the billions of dollars that the networks got, all that money. So what they going, what they, okay? And so you have people every now and then that come through and take it to another level, to another level. And if those of y'all who like reading and enjoy reading and want to get into something, read about Tesla. Brother Tesla, he's the one, probably one of the greatest scientists that ever lived. Tesla, when he was 7 years old in Hungary, he told his mother if he could ever get to Buffalo, New York, huh? He could change the world. Little child, 7 years old. Who in the hell want to go to Buffalo, man? So he gets to Buffalo when he's 27 years old. And he sees the Niagara Falls. And if it wasn't for him, we might not be alive today. You hear me? He gets there, and that's when New York, see, electricity was created in New York as we know it. And it was the direct current. And in order to use that, it was 400 or 500 people dying every week, man. And the rich white boys, said, well, no, we can't get rid of that. That's a cheap price to pay. So then the next thing they did, they wired Brooklyn, New York. And in Wine, Brooklyn, they had the first trolley cars that ran by electricity anywhere on the planet. But every now and then, the people who was riding it, they'd hear something go, zing, 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 zing. And they would jump off their train, and they would start running, but they would zigzag. What was happening with direct current, every now and then, the stuff would explode, and that electric would be looking for live bodies, either humans or animals, to ground themselves. That's where the word the Brooklyn Dodgers came from. Okay? And then all at once now, the world got in for a hard battle, man. Got in to alternating current. And nobody dies from that. This is the evil that's on this planet that we got to look at. And thank God that the Age of Aquarius, when they wrote that song, the Age of Aquarius, Age of Aquarius, the dawning of the age, because the guy wrote it 15 years before we entered the Age of Aquarius. Okay? And then in the year of 1982, we entered the Age of Aquarius. What does that mean? This country has been, this world been run and ruled, this planet, by darkness, which is men, and now the light, which is women. And so all the stuff is beginning to change now. And so that's what this game is. And then we look, and we put a certain amount of ignorance over here, a certain amount of ignorance over there, and then they got us believing, oh, the best thing you can do for your children is, if they're not listening, spank them. And did you know, I was so outraged not too long ago when I'm doing some research, and I found out as bad as whoopings are to hit a child, universally to hit a child, ain't got nothing to do with what Harvard or the church say, okay? Spare the rod and spoil the child. What's a rod? A rod is that little leather, stick-like thing that the goat herders.
Mm-hmm.
It was the shepherd boy. And all that meant is when they get over towards the ledge, because you got to walk them. They get to the edge of that cliff and get too far, you take that little stick called a rod and you just put it next to them so they know they've gone over too far. It had nothing to do with hitting them. Now, my mama read the Bible, and it tells her, spare the rod and spoil the child. So all at once now, and I have people that call me and tell me, I heard what you said, but look, I wouldn't be the person I was if it wasn't for my mother. The whooping she gave me. I thank God for those whoopings my mama gave me. I said, well, how old are you now? It's on the radio show. And she said, I'm 21, and I'm in college. And I said, 21. You live with your mother all your life until I went to college. I said, okay, get a pen and a piece of paper. 20. And write down 20. And then write down 365 multiplied by 20. That's how many years is in a day. By 20, that's how many years is in 20. Then multiply that by 3. That's how many meals you ate at home with your mother. 3 meals a day. 365 days a year for 20 years. And I've never had you say, I thank my mother for the food she gave me. You gonna thank her for a whooping? Huh? That's what made you? Now, when you get the research, and I don't want none of y'all calling me about what you fixing to hear, you go and get your own damn research, since you're so locked into this. Listen at this. This is serious research, talking about spankings and shame. Punishment leads to shame. Shame leads to anger, then to rage, and finally violence. Okay? Now, listen, you mothers and fathers out there that think this is a direction from God. Then it goes on to say, shaming is an assault on the soul that's found right by the pit of your heart. Huh? Some of y'all think it's a rhythm and a boogie. You got soul, baby. When shaming reaches the inner core of the soul, it leads to violence. Okay? Now, it continues. When the shaming is so overwhelming, the mind numbs itself, and the individual cannot feel anything. Many times leading to be a sociopath or a psychopath, a living machine that can kill or maim without feeling or remorse. Okay, now y'all talk about your whoopings if you want, if you're going to unwind this. And then I just got some research that said, wow, yelling and screaming at a child is more detrimental than hitting them, huh? Now, we didn't come up knowing that. A white racist system makes me angry, so I'm going to come home and cuss everybody out because I ain't going to say a damn thing to that white boy, okay, that rubbed my head for luck, okay? And so what I'm saying is, all of this ignorance from slavery, there's a lot of horror that goes with it, and we don't know that. We're looking for a way out, so I reach out and strike a child and strike a child and strike a child. And so all of that now, the rhythm's changing, there's people changing. I never hit a child. They told my wife, don't hit it. We come up in families where they gave you a spanking. Well, if your Cadillac has a flat tire, why don't you go and get a strap and whoop it, huh? Like you hit your child. And so again, I say, and that's the great part about shows like this here, that people hear another side other than just what they want to do to control you.
Okay, well, Brother Greg, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, but we're going to take some calls because people want to get in.
Oh, no, she was waiting for you. I told you were going to pick her up. What? She told me she was waiting for you.
Oh, Brother Steve, we can hear you on the line.
All right, okay, I'll go over
Who?
There.
Right, oh,
okay.
Bye.
Yeah, he's talking to me about well.
Be sure and follow up now, because I'm depending on you. You and you will follow up, and I'll call him, and then we'll take it to the next level.
All right, sounds good.
There we go. I just got my daughter calling.
We're about to take some calls here on the other line.
Hey, Kevin, I was just listening to your wisdom just now. You know, just thinking what a privilege it was to hear that, to tell you the truth. I mean, I was just like, I was supposed to be somewhere else and so on and so on, but I was just, you know, I just really appreciate the way you come to your points and the things you're saying are so important. And
decided that the amount of money I was making, I was going to use it to find out research. I paid $2 million and brought two doctors in. I didn't know it was going to be two. I said, "What is my research? Find me the world-renowned authority on breast milk.
Mm-hmm.
He came back and said, "You're going to be in for a shock. It's two white men that's equal, the same. Both of them rated number one." And I said, "Well, I was willing to pay $1 million, so see if I can get both of them to come in." And I carried them to Flint Goodrich Hospital, a black hospital. They was at the London School of Economics, the other one. Anyway, they agreed to come in, and I get them there, and they said, "You know, thank you for, you know, the check, but why are we doing this?" I don't know. I just do research. I do research on everything, and I'm just bringing you over here to see something I got on my mind, but if I knew it, I wouldn't bring you here. And one of the things I found out that those of you who have ever nursed a child or saw your wife nurse a child or your mother nurse a child, while the baby is being nursed on the left breast, the right breast started leaking. And I just thought that was milk. When you're with the scientists, okay, I found out that that's not milk coming out that other breast. That's poisons. That's a universal God that put that body together. If you smoke, that's nicotine coming out. If you drink, that's alcohol coming out. If you're on medicines, even if they're legal and chemical, that's coming out so the baby can't get it. Wow. Huh? That's a universal law. Not at Harvard, not at Yale, not at MIT. It was put together when that universal order that made everything put it together. Now, so I kept teasing them. I said, well, you pay us this much money, and you don't know what, I don't know what I'm looking for. So after we was all over, I carried them to the airport. They're on their way back to London. And I said, here's what I'm looking for, man. My mother's mother, all in generations, was the nannies for white folks' babies. Nannies, huh? And I'm trying to figure out how many generations do my black woman have to nurse your white baby before they become me. That's all I want to know. I've always knew how much important milk was. What's in milk? One day, the scientist is going to find out that after you cut the belly button, that belly button is not supposed to be cut for under 6 hours. Why? Because there's a different set of immune factors that come through. The first hour, there's one set of immune cells. And then after that, the next and the next. All we do is cut it, and you listen 5 hours of the news. We call people primitive. Oh, the primitive people, they have, their cousins have babies in the field and keep working. Why? Because you're supposed to squat down to have a baby the same way you do when you go to the toilet. That's why when you go to them countries that we've been taught is primitive, you don't have no bathroom. You go, there's a hole, and you squat down, and gravity pull takes care of it. And so all at once now, we're going to start learning this and seeing this. My wife used to work at the University of Chicago, where I met her before we got married. And they had a system. These rich white folks would come in, high blood pressure. And they put in something like a huge cast. You know, when you break or hurt your foot. Well, this is a huge cast, man. You put it in there, and they tell you, you're going to feel some tingling, and you're going to feel some unusual. And what it was bed bugs. We called them chinches. And I remember when I was a little boy, we would touch them, and we would squeeze them, and you get a little bit of blood, but a whole lot of oil. And we found out from that research at the University of Chicago, bed bugs were sucked up. Are all out of your bloodstream, huh? And that's the number one thing that causes high blood pressure and strokes. That's the way the rich white folks was dealing with.
All right, well, Gregory, I want to get to this line because there's a lot of people. Yeah, people are anxious. Let me go with area code 424. Sister Leia, how you doing? Well, how you doing? Welcome to the show. You're a friend of the We All Be. Move it. You got a question or some thoughts to share with Dick Gregory and our other distinguished guest, Brother Steve?
Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning to you, and God bless you.
Sorry, I forgot it's afternoon for you all.
Are you fine?
It's afternoon for y'all, but it's morning for me.
Good.
I have an epidemiological question or observation that I heard someone talking about. And I wanted to know if both of you could give me some feedback on it. And the person said that when you get flu shots, I don't believe this because I would never get a flu shot, of course, but they said when you get a flu shot, you can actually pass on the immunity to other people. Is that true?
The immunity that you got?
I'm not
making it personal, lady. We got millions of people looking to show around the world. I'm just trying to clear. You said when you get a flu shot, you can pass it on.
Exactly.
Right? Well, I heard that. I'm trying to figure how would you pass it on? By shaking hands or kissing or sex or what?
Well, That's a very good question. I mean, it made no sense to me either. I have no idea.
You can't make sense if you don't know the other part. You know, you can pass off syphilis to somebody else. You can pass off a cold to somebody else. We got this big flu epidemic going on now. You can pass it off sometimes by shaking hands. I hear some people say, no, I don't want to touch you. I got a very bad cold. All I'm asking is the question so we can answer it. Did they say you pass it on? How?
Well, it was my assumption that not passing the flu on, but passing the immunity from when they got their flu shot, they could pass on the immunity to other people, let's say just being airborne, the same way you would catch the flu, I would assume.
No, baby, but when they said, if I got a flu shot today and I came by your house, do I pass on the immunity by shaking your hand? Do I pass on the immunity by sitting on your couch? And it's bad, you sit there, that's what I'm saying. Before we can even get to the answer of the question, is how do
that's
I pass?
That's why I said airborne, meaning conversation, air in your breath, airborne.
Okay, that's what I'm saying. They say you can pass it on through that. I have no idea, but you got the boss on the show. I'm sure he can take a stab at it.
Oh, well, I can't quite figure how that would work. I think what could happen is if you had a lot of people, and let's say, I'm not crazy about the flu shot either, but let's say you had the flu shot worked. And let's say 50% of the people got the flu shot and 50% of the people didn't get it. It would be harder for the flu to transmit from, you know, around the crowd because it has to get past all those people who have immunity. So you have something which is called herd immunity, where, in fact, the level of immunity in the whole population increases when you have a certain number of people who either had gotten the disease and built up antibodies or through vaccination and so on were protected. So you could have something like that, but on an individual level, I can't quite figure how that would work, to tell you the truth. I think it's probably kind of a little bit of fuzzy thinking.
Okay, the next question I have is, I don't know how familiar you are with good disease, but it's worked somewhat like AIDS, to my understanding. And I'm wondering if the good disease, maybe Steve, you can answer, if good disease is does it break down the body faster than AIDS? Would it be something that's more critical than that of AIDS?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm not sure. I'm not familiar with that disease. I can't say, but there are different things that can break down the immune system really fast. You have certain toxins, things like that. But what I will do is I'll look it up, and get back to Brother Ron and kind of see if I can learn something about it.
And thank you, sister. You know, there's so much out here that goes on. It's for instance, when you buy, a whole lot of men buy suits, you know, $35,000 or higher, and the ones that come from Italy, when you get them, they have no belt loops. So if you want belt loops on them, you have to put the loops on them here. Why? Because your belly button, your navel, is so important, there's nothing supposed to be covering that up. Okay? Well, most folks in America don't even know that. But I notice whenever I go to Bijan's and get me an expensive suit, I have to tell them to put the belt loops on because they don't come with that. So there's a lot of things out here that go down that because of our culture have totally overlooked it or not, until I've had a hernia since I've been 9 years old and I went to get it operated on. And one of the things they told me is I can't wear a belt for, X amount of weeks. So then I got to looking it up and calling some friends of mine in Europe, and then I found out how important your belly button breathes. Just like you do, let's just your mouth breathe. Your vagina breathes. And that's one of the things that a group of us, when they came out with pantyhose, okay, and they had that made out of nylon. And I didn't realize that women started getting all in vaginal infections, almost $10 trillion a year they was paying. And it came from the infections because your vagina can't breathe through nylon. And just single-handedly, we threatened to take that case to court, the federal court, And then the company decided. That's when the panties stores were having that thin strip of cotton, and so the vagina can breathe. I never knew that, you know, because that was so far away from any the education I'd had or anything. But as you saw it doing the research, people will call you and tell you certain things. So there's a lot of things that happen. I didn't know you're supposed to sleep with your head north. No. Let me tell you, those of y'all that have babies or been around little babies, they don't turn all the way around the body, the bed. They turn north. And because we're not aware, we keep straightening them back up. They turn north and stop. And we keep straightening them back up. And so consequently, there's a whole lot of things that culture changes things that don't fit into the universal order of why you should do this and why you shouldn't do that. Thank you, ma'am, for your question.
And also, we'll go from the West Coast, from Los Angeles to... I gotta get to these calls. I gotta run these calls because a lot of people. I want to make sure everybody understands that. Make these questions short. You've got a point. Make it quick because we're running out of time. The clock is moving. So I want to make sure I get these times. But your mic is unmuted. But we're going to Delaware. Error code 302. You're on the air.
Hi, gentlemen. The gentleman on there. This is Steve Minkin.
Yes.
Okay. Did you also have something to do with a book called Reproductive Rights and Wrongs? Contributed to that?
Well, yeah, by Betsy Hartman. Is that the book by Betsy Hartman?
Okay.
She mentions me in the book. Yeah, I didn't write the book or anything.
Okay. No.
Yeah.
But okay, great. Now, let me get your preface straight. You think that HIV is a virus that is going around
absolutely.
Infecting people?
I think it's a virus.
All right, real quick, to make this short, I would like everyone listening to go and just type into Google HIV/AIDS extermination program, because it's amazing that you can have two guys, and Dick Gregory, all I can say in the nicest way, I'm disappointed, for as old as you are and for as long as you've been an activist, that I can hear so much ignorance being spewed out of your mouth. Now, like I said, this man, he's also... contributed to a book on basically depopulation. And
that's
now
really not true. That's definitely not true. I've never contributed to any kind of book on depopulation. That is a total contradiction of everything I've stood for. I said, in fact, I was very critical of the way in which contraceptive saturation programs have been used around the world. No, this is a total, this is a falsehood. I'm sorry. I don't know where you got your information from, but it's a falsehood.
Steve,
don't worry. Let me say something.
Real quick.
My philosophy is my tools don't have to be.
Dick Gregory, you're too long-winded. I can hear that stuff off the air. This man's involved in UNICEF, and in order to be or get any funding from UNICEF, you have to be part of some kind of
No, I'm not involved. That's again, that's a falsehood. I'm sorry. That's a falsehood. 40 years ago, I headed the UNICEF nutrition program, which we were concerned with was, in fact, sustaining natural resources in Bangladesh, so that people can continue their livelihoods and so on. You're making like a blanket mischaracterization.
You can throw mud at people and so on and so forth.
But get your facts straight. Your facts are not correct.
Let me tell you, your facts are total.
I don't know what your agenda is, but your facts are not correct.
Let them respond.
Let me say this here.
Thank you for your time. Thank you, sir. I appreciate it.
I learned a long time ago that truth don't have to be validated by somebody else's ignorance, okay? Two, you know how many federal agents now, I swear to you, that I'm not talking about this guy, although he could be. You know how many federal government agents calls up on shows like that to try to discredit? So who cares what he thinks when you know what you got? The biggest mistake I ever made in my life is when my food book, which changed the whole conscience of eating, black and white. But I did not know that soy was not supposed to be eaten by human beings, okay? And so the number one cancer group in America, they're vegetarians because they didn't know you wasn't supposed to eat soy. saw it was invented by Dr. George Washington Carver, and he was invented for the Pentagon. They said, can you create something for us that will get rid of, that we can make ink, paint, glue, and plastic? And that's what soy was there for that. Now, I didn't know that. And there's a whole lot of things I come up ignorance to the thing with, and I care about some chump calling up with some attitude we don't even know who they are. My record is out there. It speaks for itself. And so I don't have to sit and explain to somebody. When them redneck, ignorant white folk down south were saying, you let those Negroes vote, they'll be in the White House. Harvard didn't know that. Huh? And so there's a whole lot of stuff out here that you think you know, but I listen to the attitude, huh? The attitude of what it is. And so my record speaks for itself. I've been out of line. We don't know who you are or where you come from, but I found out one time by doing jails and benefits in no hospital. They have pay phones in no hospital. So I just wonder where that call came from. Thank you. Next call.
We got a sister, a good sister from Bmore on the East Coast as well, Sister Sabrina Green. How you doing today? And thanks for being patient.
Hi, I'm glad I'm here, and let me just say this real quickly as it's a time constraint here. As a former member of ACT UP, the person giving the very thorough evidence all needs to hear.
Mm-hmm.
I know from my comrade, Sister Carol Yanni, when she went to South Africa and did a study which she put out and found out that when it came to AIDS there, it was being, as what he explained there, with dirty syringes and the equipment that they used on the women to spread it. And that was in the workers' camp. Now, I know quite clearly that that was a radical attack, but we will not condone it nor accept it because that's the type of attack they did on Umar Johnson a couple of weeks ago. And the points that are being given here in evidence, we must clearly re-educate, understand it, because it needs much further what needs to be done as in the fight of AIDS and all terminal disease. Learn and listen.
I want to thank you very much, and I'd love to learn more about her work. Thank you.
I'll put you in touch with Sister Green.
Okay,
you
that's great.
Thank you, Sister Green, for the observation.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you.
And we got a couple, man, people that want to talk to you all. They give us these calls.
Let me say one thing.
Uh-huh.
Let me say one thing. Today is Groundhog Day, right?
Yes.
If the groundhog sees his shadow today, right?
Okay.
6 more weeks of winter, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, when you get off the show, write down February the 2nd, and spring is March the 21st, right?
Mm-hmm.
Count from February the 2nd to March the 21st. That is 6 weeks. Groundhog ain't got nothing to do with it. But, yeah, okay. And so, again, give us some more calls.
Okay, we got area code 203. Thank you for calling the We All Be.
Hey, how are you doing today?
So I'm doing blessed and highly favored. How are you doing? Highly elevated, as my Dr. Lee would say. Mm-hmm.
Hey, how you doing? This is the return of the brother off of YouTube.
Hey, return of the brother. Hey.
A little chat.
Bless you, brother.
You know what I have to do today.
Okay.
First, I have to say, Dick Gregory, you're a wonderful comedian and activist. And I love this show, and Dick Gregory, you're doing a good service for the community as well as the brother on the show.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now with that said, you know I got to go in because you say a lot of things, Dick Gregory, that you never complete, but I need for you to answer and address some situations.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we can get some clarification on some of the things that you say.
Yeah.
You ready? Okay, first question. This is a simple one, yes or no. Are you a Freemason?
No.
Okay, that's good. Now, this is the hard one now. You know I got a few. Now, I've been listening to you every now and then. You will bring up something called shapeshifters.
Called what?
Shapeshifter. What is a shapeshifter?
Shapeshifter.
What is that?
Huh? That's called the Uncle Tom.
What
shapeshifter.
Oh, okay. So you mean Uncle Tom. You don't mean like one of those reptilian type people.
No, I do mean that. Huh? Well, you going to tell me what I mean? Huh?
Okay, so is it Uncle Tom and a reptilian? That's what a shapeshifter is?
Yeah, but you...
shapeshifter.
You see, let me tell you something. I'm out here doing research, been doing research, spent millions off research, and you're going to tell me to answer a question you say yes or no. That's your business. Hmm? Okay? That's your business.
No, this,